I want you guys to come back to a more simpler time with me. I'm a teenager cleaning my room that has once again accumulated a mountain of clothes. I pull out my iPhone 4S and decide that I want to listen to some music on Pandora Radio. I'm in the mood for more comedy songs. So, like the good Christian girl that I am, I put on my Tim Hawkins radio. Except there's only like 3 songs that came on that radio, even though it was dedicated straight to Tim Hawkins. So I get more of a mixture of Weird Al Yankovic, John Mulaney, Jim Gaffigan. Before I know it, I'm out of skips and I have to just let the songs play. And then all of a sudden,
I feel like hip hop used to be a voice for the voiceless, you know? And now it's become, at least in the mainstream, a symbol of misogyny.
To this day, I'm still not exactly sure why that particular memory stuck in my mind, but I know from that point on, I really liked Bo Burnham.
Join him.
From Words, 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 What Am Make Happy, it is no secret that Bo Burnham is talented. I might go as far to say that he's not even a comedian, at least not in the traditional sense. But he's more of a performance artist. He got his start on YouTube back in 2006, and he would post songs that were funny, but they were a bit shocking and some were offensive. He got signed on by Comedy Central when he was, I believe, 17. Since then, he has really made a name for himself. He also wrote a poem book called Egghead, wrote and directed the 2018 film Eighth Grade, and acted in the TV series Zack Stone Is Gonna Be Famous, and the 2020 film Promising Young Woman. And you know what? For all those Parks and Rec people, he was this guy. After his special Make Happy, he kind of dropped off the comedy scene, with no word when or if he would return. That is until 2021, about 5 years after his last comedy special. He returned with Inside.
But look, I made you some content. Daddy made you your favorite open wide.
Unlike his other specials where he was on a stage and performing in front of a live audience, this special takes place in one single room, filmed over the course of a year with Bo alone. I have gone over in my mind whether or not I should do this review, or maybe I should just shut up.
I'm bored.
From the music, the jokes, the cinematography, the use of lighting, the editing, and the themes, there's only one way I could explain this entire special. But before we go into details, I do want to say a few things. Number one, this is an analysis and review on Bo's special on Inside, and I might divulge into his other work as well. The only thing that I own are my own opinions. Nothing I show is mine. It all belongs to Bo, and I believe as well as Netflix. That being said, it is still under fair use because I'm reviewing it. Netflix, Bo, please go easy on me. I beg of you. I am tiny. Number two, I will be touching on different sensitive topics. Although it is a comedy special, it does have some heavy themes, and I am not a professional in any regard. If you are struggling with anything that we talk about today, go talk to a professional or someone that you can trust. Number three, I will be touching on my own personal faith and religion because it is such a big part of my life. My goal is not to preach, but more to show my process and experience. However, I know that religious talk can be triggering or sensitive for some people, and so when the time comes, I will put a timestamp where you guys can skip over that. All right, now that we have all the housekeeping out of the way, I believe, let's go. With What Make Happy, and especially with Inside, everything is planned out so perfectly. Nothing is done by mistake. And there were moments in Inside where I was just in awe over all the smallest details, especially when it comes with the lighting. The use of lighting in this special is the coolest thing to me. Sometimes he has this massive production set with soft boxes and LED lights and lasers. Other times, it's literally just a single spotlight. Sometimes he utilizes the natural light out of the window, while other times he uses the spotlight or the LED light and makes it look like it is natural lighting. Sometimes he literally just uses a projector screen. You want the woods? Projector. You want a video playback of yourself to give off a concert vibe? Projector. You want a message of consent? Projection. You want a reflection of your past self or even your current self? Projectors. Best invention ever. This is no longer an analysis on Bo Burnham. This is now just Calamity's love for projectors. Another way the lighting is used is to manipulate the space, almost taking us to different places while we're never even leaving the same room. Different bits like how the world works, the reaction, use bright LED lights to make the background a certain color. Other bits like welcome to the internet and there's a lot more happening in the background, but less light is on Bo himself, especially in Welcome to the Internet, where the use of lighting gives a perspective of being in that deep space of going farther and farther and deeper into the dark abyss that we have all found ourselves trapped in at 3 a.m. One of my favorite moments is during the song 30. Bo has three separate pink lights that he controls with a pedal, along with using an LED light that he just holds with his hand. During the verses, he has one of these pink lights shining on him. And then when the chorus goes, he turns off the pink light and he uses the LED light to kind of circle around him like a spotlight. But the moment I want to talk about is during the bridge, the first time he has the pink light that shines on him in one way, and then he has another light that shines the other way, and then he has one straight on him. While this is happening, shadows are casted on the wall behind him. Once the bridge starts again, he shines all three lights, and it almost is like he has three people behind him. As he's dancing and singing to this, it looks beautiful. Now, this attention to detail goes even further when it comes to the cinematography and the editing. Depending on the bit, Bo plays around with different aesthetics and shots in order to convey the feel of the scene. Comedy starts with one establishing shot in a dark room, conveying like it's a live show on a stage. Once the song is established, it quickly moves into this bright montage to plan out how to use comedy to save the world during these trying times. It is fast-paced, it is bright, and happy in a way. The song Problematic is very similar when it comes to the fast-paced editing, but it's set more like a music video, with more of a focus on the inserts and the close-ups. Look Who's Inside Again and Don't Wanna Know are both one-shots set up in a place to almost make it look like it's candid. The room is a mess, the camera is in a weird position, and the only editing is a subtle zoom. Could be contributing to the narrative that Bo is allowing us into a more intimate and invulnerable look at this entire creative process. There are moments where he talks directly into the camera to give little updates on the process. When he turns 30 and it's the 6-month mark, he's more in a dark room at night with a soft light and a clock about to hit midnight. At the 1-year mark, he has the camera set up far away and behind a bunch of equipment. And he's talking, but he's facing a different direction away from the camera. I cannot go without complimenting aspect ratio changes. I think WandaVision kind of spoiled me with that, especially in White Woman's Instagram, where it starts out fairly normal, but the moment the chorus hits and he lights the little tiny pumpkin candle, the aspect ratio changes to the Instagram picture 360 by 360. It stays like that the whole time. There are so many details in order to give off the most basic poses, and he does it all within a Instagram square. They're not just jokes. They look fantastic. I mean, this guy is more photogenic than I am. Well, that doesn't take very much. And then the bridge hits and he starts talking about how some people might post something very vulnerable and very sad, like the anniversary of the death of a loved one. And as he goes on this little dump of memories, the aspect ratio starts to change very subtly, pans out and stretches all the way until it gets back to being widescreen, just for a split second, kind of opening you up to see the bigger picture, and then going back into the 360 by 360 Instagram square. And again, everything is crafted so well, even the order on how we see everything. There is an intermission in between, where Bo literally comes in and cleans your screen. In the first half, focus more on outward social issues and wacky over-the-top songs and skits. But as soon as 30 is over, there is definitely a tone change. And the second half gets deep and focuses more on the internal struggles that specifically Bo has. I don't think that was an accident. He has this dream, this passion to use the time that he has to use his platform for good. But as time keeps going and things are not exactly changing, Bo's mental health starts to decline until he hits an extremely low point. It's a show of watching this man descent into madness. Jeffrey Bezos. Oh. I think we can all agree that the best part of this entire special is the use of music. Every single song is so pleasant to listen to. The melodies are easy and flow so well, but the thing that really gets me is the harmonies. Take this example from the song Comedy.
If you wake up in a house that's full of smoke, don't panic. Call me and I'll tell you a joke. If you see white men dressed in white cloaks, don't panic. Call me and I'll tell you a joke.
On top of the beautiful harmonies and how the songs sound, Bo is a lyrical genius. He always has been, and this really shines in his special too. I think my favorite is the final song, where he takes parts from All Eyes on Me, Welcome to the Internet, Comedy, and Look Who's Inside Again. He rewrites them to how they fit how he feels.
If I wake up in a house that's full of smoke, I'll panic. So call me up and tell me a joke. When I'm fully irrelevant, totally broken, damn it. Call me up and tell me a joke.
But you want to know the epitome of great lyricism?
You did it!
Every song touches on something to get you thinking. Some of them, like I mentioned before, touch on social issues. How the World Works is a comedic commentary song, shining light on the way we teach kids about the reality of the world and how it has been whitewashed. It also shines light on how some people are oblivious and uneducated, and those who are educated might get mad at those who don't know, rather than having sympathy and benefit of the doubt and sharing the knowledge to help one another understand. Another way to interpret it is that those that have power abuse those that are lower class. Even after saying they want to help, but they don't actually want to help, they abuse their power. I think Bo could have taken the moral lesson of the song and taken some time to educate himself on the proper puppet etiquette. Stop flopping the lid. Just use your thumb to move the bottom jaw. That's not how anyone talks. I literally just came back from a camp where we taught this to 8-year-olds, and they got it. How many times do I have to scream bad puppet at the screen? How many times, Bo? Huh? How many times? The song genuinely sounds like it's straight out of the Muppets, so I'll give you that. But learn how to use a freaking puppet, Bo. Problematic hits on cancel culture. The way it could be interpreted is A, he's literally asking people to hold him accountable, or B, hitting on the irony of it and having the faux apologies that kind of circle around how people will apologize but not exactly mean it and not change their actions. Welcome to the Internet takes us down the spiral we have all experienced, all while sounding fun and yet still menacing, while bringing up the issue of having any and all information right at our fingertips, and yet it desensitizes us to everything. It's a great villain song, I'll just say that. Has a different structure with having a fun, funky beat that is genuinely fun to listen to, all while the lyrics are talking about the opposite. It's a sad song conveyed in a happy way. It's literally an Owl City song. Out of all the songs, the one with the most impact, the one that's the most vulnerable, and the one that is the pivotal moment of the entire special is All Eyes on Me. Bo tries to give a 1-year update, but after trying and trying, he realizes he can't, and he storms off. Then we're immediately cut to in front of the mirror with the camera and Bo, like how we started. Bo finally accepts that he is not doing good. As soon as he does, he breaks down, and with a slow zoom into the camera, we're transported to this vulnerable and very personal song. Now, Bo tends to have a song either at the very end or the second to last song that is a shift away from the comedy to get real and have a peek inside his mind, but also into our own minds. We think we know you. Can't handle this. Are you happy? And inside, it is 100% All Eyes on Me. The sound mixing, the visuals, the lyrics all play a part to convey this feeling of drowning, falling, being in a deep pit. It elicits an emotion, whether it's empathetic or it draws something out of you. You can't help but feel something with this song. My brother literally called this depression propaganda. And although it is by far the best song in this entire special, subjectively, there's only one way that I could describe it, and it sounds hopeless. As much as we want to help and make a difference, there are just things that we cannot change, or they are too far gone. It is saying that basically, we're screwed. Enjoy the ride. However, I have a different take. This is where my faith and religion comes in, and my own personal interpretation. So if you don't want to hear that, you are more than welcome to skip to this time. I was rewatching the special for this analysis. Up until this point, this song really stuck with me, but I could not understand why it stuck and it made me feel different. Of course, it does have this really sad feeling, and it follows a part where Bo is extremely vulnerable. And I have this kind of thing where I think I'm an empath, and so if it makes you cry, it'll stick with me a little bit farther. Before I did this, I prayed because I wanted to be open for something new, and the song played and I really felt something different. Rather than having that hopeless feeling, the earth is on fire, feeling like I'm drowning, I have this new feeling of hope. How can I put this? The song itself is Bo basically portraying like a concert, and I have seen people compare it to like an evangelical worship session. He's basically telling people, look to me, I've been through it, I've been through what you're going through. But I felt that I shouldn't be looking at Bo, rather shift my gaze to Jesus, and imagine that he was singing it, which sounds very weird. It literally says, get your effing hands up. So it's definitely not a worship song whatsoever. And yet, when I imagined that, even the bridge itself gave this tiny sense of hope. And it reminded me a lot of the story of Peter and Jesus on the water. Jesus is walking on the water and there's a storm. Peter said, if it's really you, tell me to call you out on the water. So he does. Peter starts walking on the water. He gets out of the boat and starts walking on the water toward Jesus, and he's looking at Jesus. But the moment he looks at the waves and he sees the storm and he takes his eyes off of Jesus and he becomes afraid, he falls in and he calls out to Jesus, and Jesus picks him up immediately. Now, to apply this to the song itself, I mean, just listen to this verse. You say the ocean is rising like I give a shit. You say the whole world's ending, honey, it already did. You're not gonna slow. If you just imagine, instead of it being the entire earth, but it's more so the things that I overthink, because I tend to overthink things and I deal with a lot of anxiety. It's why this video is 2 months late. And I tend to build stuff up in my mind so much. But the minute that I give it to God, it's like nothing. He doesn't care about the things that I overthink. He doesn't care about the things that I have done. He doesn't care about the things that I go over and over in my brain. I mean, he cares about them enough, you know, to die for my sins. He cares enough about them for him to take them from me. But the moment he does, he casts them away, because compared to him, they're nothing.
I forgive you.
And he doesn't want me wallowing in my self-pity. He doesn't want me wallowing in my anxieties. He just wants me to focus on him. And I forget that very often. This is just a new interpretation of the same thing he's been telling me for the past 10 years, is to trust him, keep my eyes on him. But I forget that. I forget that so much. When I looked at this song with that perspective, something really changed the way that I saw this entire special. Like I said before, it kind of follows Bo through this journey of, you could either interpret it as quarantine or mental health or however you want to interpret it. But you kind of see this journey that he starts off high and excited to put out this special. And as time goes on, you see his mental health kind of deteriorating. And as it's taking more and more time, he's getting more and more frustrated until he finally breaks down. And then after that moment, you'll almost have like a glimmer of hope. Goodbye kind of takes the themes of the entire show and ties them all together, kind of saying, I still have things that I need to work on. But All Eyes on Me, even though it does have this feeling of drowning and falling, there is just this glimmer of hope. Our anxieties might still be there. I'm not going to sit here and say that they wouldn't be, because I've been following God my entire life and I still struggle with anxiety. If we don't focus our eyes on external things and focusing on my mind, but rather on God and on Jesus, nothing else really matters in the grand scheme of things, because he is perfect and he is there for me. So what does this mean? What was the reason for Bo's special? What were Bo's intentions?
What do you think, industrial piping? Close. Stay out of it.
I have seen a lot of people contribute to this conversation. Is it about quarantine, mental health, the overall state of the world on fire? My conclusion is irrelevant. What I said before, Bo is a performance artist. Everything he puts his mind to, everything that he has put out, especially when it comes to comedy, is art. He probably does have an agenda for what he wanted. He had a way of how he wanted it. I was saying that everything is planned out to a T. He never says, oh, this song means this, or the reason for this bit was this. Because really, it's all up for interpretation and how we can relate to it. Inside was definitely more dense for a comedy show, but it is art, and art is subjective. I see so many people relating to Funny Feeling, while for me, I didn't as much as I did with All Eyes on Me. One person could read Bezos 1 and 2 and are able to deconstruct it about how Jeff Bezos kind of exploits his own employees and roasts the top by digging away through, I don't know. While others, it's just silly songs with Bo, the part of the show where Bo comes out and sings a silly song.
Congratulations!
White Woman's Instagram has many interpretations of what I've seen, from making fun of to paying homage to the women that post these kind of pictures, cracking jokes at them to show the irony of the culture of Instagram, or kind of encouraging men to embrace more their feminine side. It is all up for interpretation. And we may never get a full explanation on the entire show, because that's not what the point of the show was. The point was for Bo to step back into comedy and to create something in his own way. Which brings me to my next point. I've been saying this entire time that everything is purposefully in this special. Even if it was due to circumstance that Bo had to make this in his home alone instead of in front of a live studio audience, it worked in his favor. Because with the ability to film and edit it all himself, he's able to show us only what he wanted to. This is completely in character for Bo. Even on his stage shows, he's very meticulous with what he does and what he does not show.
There's some misting up the water over, yeah, yeah, yeah. But you all thought it was an accident, but he meant to knock the water over, yeah, yeah, yeah. Art is a lie, nothing is real.
Bo is in control the entire time. That is the whole shtick of this entire special. There are times where there are random shots just spliced around. Even in the times where he is vulnerable, it is all for show for us. If he didn't want us to see that, he would have turned off the camera. He wouldn't have set it up in the first place. And even if he did record it and it happened unannounced, he would have cut it out. But everything is done with a purpose. And yes, I even mean the one frame. He had a vision and he ran with it. He was able to convey that vision for us. What was the meaning of it? I honestly cannot tell you. I honestly think you need to watch it for yourself to understand, first of all, what the heck I'm talking about, but also to draw your own conclusions. Now, there's so much more I could say about this special. I mean, my brother and I are constantly discussing the different songs, and I even had a lovely conversation with someone at a bookstore who was saying they were frustrated no one is talking about the racial symbolism of Sako and how the world works, which, I will be completely honest, I never thought of it that way. But there is one thing for sure, Bo has made a masterpiece, and I do have a prediction that I think he has set the standard for the decade. I could see this being the inspiration for a lot of people's content. Take Jacksepticeye's short film, 15 Months, for example. This is an intimate, silent short film about Jack's physical health struggles. But as you watch it, you can clearly see that it was inspired by Inside. He even mentioned in a past video that he wants to delve deeper into creating more artistic videos. And I really think, and I really hope as well, that we will see much more content like this. In a time where people are flocking to entertainers that really don't do anything spectacular, I want to see more stuff where nothing is held back and we can mix art with our own internal struggles and experience. I will be honest and say that if you are a Christian or you have conservative views, there is some shocking imagery and he curses a lot. If you're open to laugh but also to think, I would highly suggest watching this. I don't really have anything negative to talk about, and I might be a little bit biased because I have been watching Bo for so many years. It's so well thought out, and with the great editing, the beautiful cinematography, the use of lighting, and the songs. Is it bad that I want to give it a 10 out of 10 as my first review? I don't care. I would give it a 10 out of 10 because it's peak cinema, honestly. It is definitely something different, but it's a good different. And now, I finally have this done and out into the world. Now I can get back to living my life without being fixated on a piece of media. Oh, come on! Hey guys, thank you so much for watching this video. I know it's a little bit different than something that I've done in the past. I wanted to really try this out. I watch a lot of video analyses on movies and TV shows and stuff like that, and I wanted to give my hand a try on this. And so I have a couple more that I have lined up, and we will see how they go. And if people like them, I might keep them going. If you are new to the channel, you are more than welcome to subscribe and look out for more videos like this. You can check out my videos in the past that are all very much a variety of stuff. If you like the video, like it. And if you didn't like it, you're welcome to dislike it as well. We love some constructive criticism here. Leave a comment if you would like. Check out my Twitch channel and my other social medias down in the description. There's also a audio only version of this exact same video on my personal podcast, God in Film, and there's a link to that in the description, as well to my other podcast with my dear friend Loki the Octo, down in the description as well, called Gamer v Filmer. I hope you guys have a great rest of your day, and I will see you in the next video. Have a good one, guys.